Welcome back from that short break. And of course, it's about that time we get to dive into some sport this morning. Give you a little bit of a sneak peek on what to expect later on at exactly 1:30, or some of the news that you could have probably missed out as far as different sports are related. Now, joining me on set to give me most of that update is Nicholas Nick Lubobi. Good morning to you, Nicholas.
A very beautiful Wednesday morning, 8th of 8th, 1-8.
Yes.
How often do you get 6-6-6? Usually when you, in 2006, during the month of July, actually June, the 666 number, that
when,
kind of,
when
it sounds satanic.
When their account is having like 66 shillings left.
So that, it's a trigger of the number.
But today I can relate.
Today we have 8818.
There's still some money. We're still
good. How are you though?
I'm good. How was your night?
Quite drastic, I should say. Leaving your bed knowing that you have another 8 hours or 9 hours plus to look forward to. But yeah, not complaining. The days of our lives.
I keep blaming it on Eve. If only she hadn't eaten the forbidden fruit, who knows, we wouldn't be here. But anyway, let's talk sports. Beginning it off with the ladies, the She Cranes, who actually did receive their facilitation as far as the sports equipment is concerned, as far as they get ready for the World Cup that is going to be happening, the qualifiers.
Well, yesterday in Kampala, the rich man, David Katuma, a very familiar individual to many sports peoples, did come out to support the She Cranes with sports equipment and also shillings, 3.5 million, to have them get ready for the forthcoming 2018. Netball World Cup qualifiers. There's been so much talk about how the She Cranes have suffered over the years, but they had a very glorious and handsome and juicy campaign in 2017. They won their maiden Africa Netball Championship under the same man in Vincent Chuanuka, who is very pleased with the mood in camp. Of course, they are in their final preparation for the big one in Zambia. That's the 2019 Netball World Cup qualifiers, slated for the 13th to the 18th of August. And you want to believe that with the support they've been getting right from last year, when they won the maiden African Netball Championship, going into this year when they finished sixth in the concluded Gold Coast Olympic Games. They have been getting that moral and financial support from both the government and the well wishers. And to see David Katuma coming out to provide them with this sports equipment, it simply shows one thing, that there is still more love out there for the She Cranes, who will be out to compete for a place in the forthcoming Netball World Cup to be held in Liverpool. That's next year down at the Echo Arena. But yeah, they will be, of course, facing teams like Namibia, that will be on their first day against Malawi in there on the next day. That will be the 15th. And then on Thursday, two games will be lined up for the She Cranes, against Kenya in the morning and against Botswana. You want to think around the time, there should not be any mathematics or calculations behind. This should be a definite qualification for the She Cranes, who've got so much experience, legs in there. Pretty much the same faces in Peace Proskovia, who's of course with the Logboru Netball Club side in the UK. We talk about Rachel and Florence Nanyonga, Meme Ruth. All these are great ads and great fields in terms of experience and leadership to have the She Cranes qualify for the forthcoming Netball World Cup. And I want to believe that Vincent Chuanuka, who's got very familiar hands with these girls in terms of the coaching skills, will definitely have this team in the She Cranes qualify for the second World Cup, having come through the year 2015.
Looking at the tremendous ways they have been performing in their previous games, should we actually be, you know, confident that this time around we can even make it to the World Cup finals?
I think we should, Derek. Obviously, looking at the 2015 campaign, it was our first time playing in, you know, at such top level as far as netball is concerned. And over the years since then, 2015, netball has seemed to have improved. The curve has been going right up there. I mean, the 2017 success that I talked about earlier on, and the 2018 as well, a very good campaign in Gold Coast, finishing in sixth place. I think there is so much hope and so much confidence among those players that I just mentioned to go out there and get the job done.
Quite interesting. Let's wait and see how they tend to unfold with that tournament. Now, moving on, the under-18 women's basketball has been flagged off to Maputo. Now, the biggest question is expectations. What should we expect from this team?
A very tall order, if you ask me. When you look at this side, the under-18, these are new youngsters. Every other year, you have new blood coming through, because then it's strictly under-18. And every year, you expect these youngsters to graduate to the under-19 or 21. And that is the fast track done by FUBA, the sports governing body. And yesterday, they were flagged off via Lugogo with the National Council sports officials. And also, Ambrose Tashobia coming out to speak well of the under-18 side currently coached by that is Ali Mavita. Ali Mavita has done tremendously well with his team. They finished second in the recent regional Zone 5 championship down in Tanzania. That was last month in July, and in the last edition 2016, where, by the way, none of these 12 players did feature, because like I said, as the years go by, these faces change because of the time frame and also the age bracket.
The age bracket, yes.
You'd want to think 2016 finishing in 8th place, 2018 new blood all through the 12-man squad. There is some sort of hope. You could see the vibrancy in camp. Speaking to the young girls yesterday in Lugogo, they're very excited, not just about the trip to Maputo, getting on that plane, but also the fact that they are representing the nation in Uganda. So they will be up against teams like Algeria, Tunisia, Ivory Coast, Angola, Rwanda, defending champions in Mali. It will be too much to ask of them. That's the under 18 girls team to go up there and cause some shockers. But well, with a little bit of experience from the regional Zone 5 championship, just maybe they might of course go out there and nick this one here. But it is of course the championship, that's the under 18 girls championship, to be held in Maputo starting on the 10th to the 19th of August.
You talked about something to do with expecting them to do perform a lot, but looking at the teams that will be meeting down there, I think they have a little bit more of experience compared to these young girls.
I do agree with you, definitely
performing for the very first time. So what should be the list that we should expect out of
maybe
this team?
Maybe third place, fourth place. But like I say, this is a whole new team altogether.
Yes.
Asking Ali to assemble a team to go out there and defeat all the nations down in Maputo will be too much to ask. It will not be a walk in the park for the under 18 Gazelles team, but a little bit of team effort in there, and maybe aggressive approach, especially from their first game. Because when you win your first game, it gives you momentum and rhythm going into your next game. And losing your first game will definitely be a very big blow for you. As far as going into match day 2 is concerned. But for Ali Mavita, I think the only thing she can be right now is being optimistic, positive, and hope that the girls will go out there and represent and compete, and not just to make numbers.
All right, let's wait and see how they drive to bring those points home. Now, finally, the Fiesta team has been flagged off to go and represent the country down in Rwanda. Facilitation did come in time. Now, the biggest question is, should we expect any excuses for any slim performance?
We've got to go out there and get the job done. Maximum points. Last year in Gulu Municipality, there was, of course, question marks around the facilitation team Uganda. This is a competition that is held every year. It is the Federation East African Secondary School Sports Association Games. And for Uganda, of course, finishing in second place last year, there is no excuse. Facilitation has come on time. The athletes are up and ready for this event down in Musanze, Rwanda, where we'll be up against five other East African nations in a host Rwanda, Tanzania, South Sudan, along with Kenya and Burundi. And you can only hope that they will go out there and get the maximum points required. Of course, it's based on the number of wins you secure in the sporting disciplines. That is how they tally the points. And last year, our strongest disciplines were football, netball, handball, volleyball, and that is basketball. You want to think we'll probably have the same replica, and only this time around hope to finish above Kenya, who are the defending champions, having won the last edition in Uganda, held in Gulu. But for Team Uganda, over 1,500 athletes have been confirmed, and they will be heading out this week for the Fiesta Games, scheduled for 10th Augusto to the 20th. It will be probably two weeks, I should say, down in Musanze. Everything is up and ready. Facilities are in round, of course, are spot on. So there's only one way to do this. Go out there and showcase yourself, win in every discipline. We talk about the others, football, rugby, basketball, which should be our main focus in terms of getting the points. But for Team Uganda, I'm very, very happy with the way they've organized themselves. Preparations have been quite intensive, organizing these athletes to get themselves ready for the forthcoming Fiesta Games to be held in Rwanda. And you can only hope that when they do get there, obviously the question of kids going out there to represent their country, there won't be any case of disappearance, because usually when you fly
when
over,
yes, we have those instances.
It's Rwanda, so where could you possibly run to?
Talking about being in Rwanda, this is actually the first time that a Fiesta is being hosted in Rwanda. Now, the biggest question is, shouldn't be worried about Rwanda, bearing in mind that it will have the home ground advantage?
Obviously, definitely. Home ground advantage plays a key factor in every event that you do take part in. But again, for me, it goes down to the quality of players that you do have in your respective squad. And for Team Uganda, like I said, a number of these chaps took part in the last edition in 2017. So they are very familiar in terms of team chemistry, in terms of game approach from their coaches, because now you're dealing with 1,000 plus athletes in football, handball, plus other sporting disciplines. It is very important for them to be focused and also have the positive vibe in them, especially flying out to Rwanda. Hopefully it will be by air transport, because there's been talk about them using road transport.
That's a very long journey. Facilitation didn't come in time, so we hope even the tickets did come on time.
Facilitation could mean pocket money and food.
Let's hope they have some tickets.
For all the 1,000.
It gives you a good
that's
feeling.
That's an Airbus Plus.
It gives you a good feeling, you know. Let's just hope for the best.
I think that's those must be three buses on how do they call that place? Is it Mabira?
Mabira.
Not an Airbus. Because then Airbus, there's 1,000 plus students on that craft.
Both economy and the business class. So we'll see how
that's how much money. That's a lot of money. But anyway, most important thing, they'll be going out there to represent Uganda.
Quite interesting. Now, let's come back to the big game that's going to be happening today as far as basketball can be related to. KCCA up against City Oilers. Now, previously, City Oilers has not been the team to look forward to, or even a team where you could place your money. This time around, they're playing KCCA without their big man or team. Now, the big question is, can they get to bounce back to the winning ways tonight?
Well, you mentioned getting back to winning ways. That, of course, reminds me of that defeat against KU Titans, 79-94. A defeat that you saw coming, because they're not very good in terms of getting themselves back after they do lose a game. But for KCCA, coming into this particular fixture, it is a tall order. This is a newly promoted side from the first division, currently third from bottom. And for them to come out and defeat City Oilers, that will be a shocker, if you ask me, on paper. You mentioned the other X factor of General Tim. Yes. General Tim traveled to the States for further studies, and he will not be available for selection tonight. But that doesn't take anything away from Oilers, because they have plenty to choose from. I mean, spoiled for choice. For City Oilers, talk about Stephen Omon, Jimmy Nabu, Ben Kumaker, Johnson Josh, along with Jonathan Egao. Those are their two new signings. They have plenty to choose from in terms of team selection. And for KCCMN, I mean, the last time they were in action, they shocked Pemba Warriors on the night. That game ending 77-54. You might want to think that's a huge booster for them coming into tonight's game against the defending champions and five-time NBL winners in City Oilers. And they'll be banking on the services of Emmanuel Udonkara in there, who scored a game high against the Pemba Warriors team of 17 points. Innocent Ondoor as well, expected to be out there. Andrew Gang and Francis Mbuyi. But like I said, this should be City Oilers' win. Why? Because of the quality that they do possess on that squad, and the fact that it is City Oilers. I mean, for the first time in a very long while, I haven't seen a team carry so much confidence. That is in KCCMN's
But it hasn't been the City Oilers we have been used for a couple of games that he did play.
Well, you could say most of their players were engaged on national duty in terms of them being with the Silverbacks, and that took something away from them, because you talk about Jimmy Nabu, Benko Makech, Tony Dreleba, Stefano Moyne, all those have been away, and every time you don't have your key players, it is a setback for you as a coach. But for Oilers, I think they've done a tremendous job so far. They're very good, they're very poor at starting, but as the season progresses, they tend to blend into the league and then somehow get the right result. Prior to the defeat against KU Titans, they had gone six games and beaten. That was a winning streak, if you ask me, record in the second round of the National Basketball League. But without a doubt, maximum points will be required today for the Oilers. And like I said, it will be a shocker if KCCMN's team gets a result against the five-time and defending champions in City Oilers. But just a quick one. We do have A1 Challenge also up against JKL Lady Dolphins. That is a fixture to look forward to. A1 Challenge has seemingly been a threat to the top three giants in the women's category. Why? Because they've been getting results week in, week out. And for JKL Lady Dolphins, talk about Flavio Kecho, our very own Flash. Yes. Jamila Nasikombi back from the 3-3, along with their other player in Muhaimuna Namuwaya. She's also a netballer, by the way. So this should be an exciting encounter between L1 Challenge up against JKL. But the biggest one, will be KCCA and City Oilers. A game to look out for tonight down in Wandiga at exactly 8 p.m.
All right. Thank you very much, Nicholas, for that amazing information. And there you have it. Some of the interesting games to look out for as far as sports can be related to. And for the big basketball fans, talking about the men that would like to enjoy the KCCA game up against City Oilers, it is tonight. We'll see you guys down in Wandiga. That has been it for sport. We're going for a short break, but when we do get back, Abantu still continues.